Hello viewers, welcome to the Bachelor course of Population Studies. Today we will discuss about the most important topic of understanding and interpretation of demographic data. This lecture describes how to interpret the data into meaningful information for research purpose. In India, the first census was held in 1872. India demographics occupy second rank among the world's most populated countries. With its current population of more than 1.21 billion people, as per the Census of India 2011, the country is estimated to surpass China and be the leading populous country in the world. The total population of the nation is growing at the rate of 1.41%. Before understanding about the data interpretation, we first discuss about the nature and the forms of data. In this lecture, very simple and easy examples of data forms have been used to explain the concept of data. A simple listing of observations might be sufficient for interpreting the data. In case a data set consists of few entries only, but in case of large data set, the simple listing of observation may not be sufficient for data interpretation. Here, the data are usually organized into groups called classes and presented in a table which gives the number of observations in each group. Such a table gives a better overall view of distribution of data and enables one to rapidly assess important characteristics of the data. Similarly, the use of graphs, charts, table, etc. expresses the data in a meaningful way. Let us first discuss about the role and importance of data in research work. Meaning and nature of data. Data refers to the non-facts or things used as a basis for inference, information, and material to be processed or stored. For a patient, the doctor advises recording of the body temperature of the patient at regular intervals. If you record the body temperature of the patient over a period of time, what you are recording is known as data. Various forms of data. For understanding the nature of data, it becomes necessary to study about the various forms of data, and it includes number one, qualitative and quantitative data, number two, continuous and discrete data, number three, primary and secondary data. Let us discuss them briefly. Qualitative and quantitative data. Let us consider a set of data that consists of number of colleges according to management in your area. The details are given below in table 1.1. Table 1.1 depicts management-wise number of colleges. In table 1.1, number of colleges have been shown according to the management. So, the colleges have been classified into four categories, namely government colleges, local body colleges, private aided colleges and private unaided colleges. A given college belongs to any one of the four categories. Such data is known as categorical or qualitative data. Here, the management of the college is referred as the category. Such categories are listed alphabetically or in order of decreasing frequencies or in some other conventional way. Each piece of data clearly belongs to one classification or category, such as on the basis of gender, caste, occupation, etc. Let us consider a set of data that consists of number of colleges according to enrollment. The details are given below in the table 1.2. Table 1.2 depicts number of colleges according to enrollment. In table 1.2, number of colleges have been shown according to the enrollment of students in the college. Colleges with enrollment varying in a specified range are grouped together. For example, there are 15 colleges where the students enrolled are any number between 51 and 100. As the grouping is based on numbers, such data are called numerical or quantitative data. Let us discuss about continuous and discrete data. Numerical or quantitative data may be continuous or discrete, depending on the nature of elements or objects being observed. Let us consider the table 1.3 depicting the heights of students of a class. In table 1.3, the data pertaining to the heights of students of a class is given. Here, the element under observation is the height of the students. The height varies from 4 feet 8 inches to 6 feet. Two students may vary by almost 0 inch height. Even if we take two adjacent points, say 4 feet 8.00 inches and 4 feet 8.01 inches, there may be several values between the two points. Such data are called continuous data, as the height is continuous. Continuous data arise from the measurement of continuous attributes or variables, in which individual may differ by amounts just approaching zero. Weights and heights of children, temperature of a body, intelligence and achievement level of students, etc. are the examples of continuous data. In discrete data, no real value may ever be found. Such data are usually expressed in whole numbers. The size of a family, enrollment of children, number of books, etc. are the examples of discrete data. Generally, the measurable data is continuous in nature, while countable data is discrete. Let us consider once again table 1.2, which is showing the number of students enrolled and number of colleges according to enrollment. Let us consider the enrollment of two colleges as 60 and 61. Now, in between 60 and 61, there cannot be any number, as the enrollment will always be in whole numbers. Thus, there is a gap of 1 unit from 60 to 61. Such data where the elements being observed have gaps are called discrete data. Next, primary and secondary data. The data collected by or on behalf of the person or people who are going to make use of the data refers to primary data. For example, the attendance of children, result of examinations conducted by you is primary data. When an individual personally collects data or information pertaining to an event, it refers to primary data. Sometimes an investigator may use the data already collected by you, such as the school attendance of children or performance of students in various subjects, etc. refers to secondary data. Such data should be used very carefully, since the data could have been collected with a purpose different from that of the investigator and may lose some detail or may not be fully relevant. For using secondary data, it is always useful to know about its collection procedure, accuracy, summarization, analysis, and interpretations. Let us discuss demography and demographic data. Demography is the statistical study of changes in population size, composition, and its distributions. The word demography is divided into two parts, where demo means the people and graphy means measurement. Demography focuses on the following aspects of human populations. Number one, size, which increase or decrease in population size. Second, composition, gender and age group of population and distribution, territory or area wise. The demographic data are obtained from a census of population, the national sample surveys, and from records of events like birth, deaths, migrations, marriages, divorces, diseases, and employment. This is very useful for research organizations to further explore on this data for various purposes. Data can be analyzed on various parameters, such as on the basis of age, income level, gender, occupation, caste, marital status, area, etc. These are termed as demographic factors. The Indian census is the most credible source of information on demography, also known as population characteristics, economic activity, literacy and education, housing and household amenities, urbanization, fertility and mortality, scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, language, religion, migration, disability and many other socio-cultural and demographic data. Census 2011 is the 15th national census of the country. Census is the only source of primary data in the village, town and ward level. It provides valuable information for planning and formulation policies for central and state governments and is widely used by national and international agencies, scholars, business people, industrialists, and many more. Census is the basis for reviewing the country's progress in the past decade, monitoring the ongoing schemes of the government, and most importantly, plan for the future. Let us have a quick look at the information which can be gathered from the demography of our nation as per the Census of India 2011. Population distribution in India by states and union territory. The total population or size of community is defined as the number of persons residing there. The total population is assessed at regular intervals by the national census. Between censuses, the total population is estimated either by extrapolation from the last census or through more complicated component methodologies, which involve mini projections of separate components of population up to the target estimate date. The below mentioned table 2.1 provides us information regarding the state and union territory wise details of India's population. In the above table 2.1, column 1 represents the rank that was assigned on the basis of population. It means that the rank 1 is assigned to those states or union territories which has more population. Here Uttar Pradesh is assigned one rank as it has population of 19,98,12,341, which is high as compared to the other states or UTs in India, whereas Lakshadweep has least population of 64,473 and ranked 36 in the above table. Sikkim has least population among all states with population of 6,10,577. Delhi has more population among union territories. It has population of 1,67,87,941. Column 2 provides the names of states and union territories in India. As we all know, there are 29 states and 7 union territories. Here, 29 states are Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Bihar, West Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Rajasthan, Karnataka, Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Telangana, Kerala, Jharkhand, Assam, Punjab, Chhattisgarh, Haryana, Jammu and Kashmir, Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, Tripura, Meghalaya, Manipur, Nagaland, Goa, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Sikkim, and 7 territories are Delhi, Puducherry, Chandigarh, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu, and Lakshadweep. Column 3 is representing the information of either it is state or union territory. Column 4 gives the details of population as per Indian Census 2011, which shows that the state Uttar Pradesh has highest population of 19,98,12,341 and Maharashtra is second in terms of population and has population of 11,23,74,333. Similarly, the details about population of all states and union territories is given here. Column 5 shows the state-wise percentage of the population. Here, Uttar Pradesh contributes 16.5% of the total Indian population and can be calculated as Uttar Pradesh population multiplied by 100 divided by population of India, that is 19,98,12,341 multiplied by 100 divided by 121,08,54,977, that is equal to 16.5%. Similarly, the percentages of all the states can be calculated in this way. Here, all the 7 union territories contributes 1.67% of the total population, whereas all the state contributes 98.33% of the total population. Column 6 and column 7 gives the details of rural and urban population of corresponding states or UT respectively. Here Uttar Pradesh has highest rural population, but in terms of urban population, Maharashtra leads Uttar Pradesh with the highest urban population of 5,08,27,531. The total population of India is 121,08,54,977 and can be calculated as sum total of population of 29 states and 7 union territories. The total rural population of India is 83,03,87,662 and total urban population is 37,71,05,760. Here the rural population contributes 68.81% and the urban population contributes 31.19% of the total population. This data gives the information that India has more rural population. Next, demographic distribution on the basis of gender. Table 2.2 depicts demographic distribution on the basis of gender. The above table 2.2 shows that the total number of males and females are 62,37,24,248 and 58,64,69,174 respectively. Among all states and UT, Uttar Pradesh has more number of males and females that contribute 16.75% and 16.25% of the total population respectively, whereas Lakshadweep has less number of males and females that contributes 0.0053% and 0.00534% of the total population respectively. Kerala has highest sex ratio of 1,084, whereas Daman and Diu has lowest sex ratio of 618 among all states and union territories. Next, population trend from 1951 to 2011. In 1951, India has population of 36,10,88,000 and in 2001 it has increased up to 121,08,54,977. The following table 2.3 gives the trend analysis of Indian population from 1951 to 2011. Just have a look on this table. In 1961, its population was 43,92,35,000 and that was 21.6% change from the previous census year. In 1971, its population was 54,81,60,000, that showed 24.8% of change. Similarly, its population was 68,33,29,000. 84,63,87,888, 102,87,37,436, and 121,08,54,977. In 1981, 1991, 2001, and 2011 respectively. The above mentioned data can be expressed with the help of charts and graphs. Figure 1 represents the population trend of India from 1951 to 2011, that is already explained above. Figure 1 depicts population trend from 1951 to 2011. Have a look at the following figure 2. Figure 2 depicts percentage decadal growth rates of population in India from 1951 to 1961 to 2001 to 2011. The percentage decadal growth during 2001 to 2011 has registered the sharpest decline. This decadal growth has become 17.7%, a decrease of 3.8 percentage points from 21.5% for the period 1991 to 2001. One of the important features of 2001 to 2011 decades is that it added lesser population as compared to previous decade. This implies that as a result of the combination of population momentum and somewhat impaired fertility, although India continued to grow in size, but its pace of net addition is on the decrease. At the end, it can be concluded that the organizations of data is most important for interpretation purpose. Depending on the nature of elements, the data may be in the form of qualitative or quantitative, continuous or discrete, primary or secondary. The proper classification of data makes it easy for interpretation purpose, and that can be analyzed in number of ways. That's all with today's lecture. I hope this must have raised your concerns about this important topic in research work. Have a nice time. Goodbye.